You're watching the webcast of the 2011 Los Angeles Religious Education Congress, live from the Convention Center in Anaheim, California. Está sintonizando la transmisión del Congreso de Educación Religiosa 2011 en vivo desde Anaheim, California.
We are back live at the Religious Education Congress in Los Angeles 2011. Here at the epicenter of it all, this is the exhibit hall where people gather to share, to buy, and to really experience Catholicism at its best. And I am privileged to be joined by an amazing priest from Australia, Father Richard Leonard. How are you?
Alex, it's a great pleasure to be with you today.
And he's telling me he's still a little bit jet-lagged. How long was that flight?
I'm a bit jet-lagged. It's a 17-hour flight from Sydney to Los Angeles.
Oh,
and I only got in last night to L.A. And so I'm just it's still with me today, I'd have to say. So if I go to sleep in the middle of this, we'll need all our people who are watching us right now to call in or send us an email and wake us up.
Now, Father Richard Leonard is no stranger to Congress, especially no stranger to the young adult community. He has presided over several liturgies. What is it like to serve the youth and to engage with them?
I have had just the best experiences here at Congress. This is my ninth year of being invited back.
You're a veteran.
I'm a veteran. And one of the lovely things about coming back is that you get to see your friends all over again. So this is a wonderful annual invitation that at the moment I'm receiving and delighted to accept. And then my particular involvement was from the earliest days, doing a couple of youth days, and then I was invited to preside over the Eucharist for young people. And the energy in those rooms, the faith in those rooms, it's not just that it's dynamic and exciting, but the silence that you can have in those liturgies where you've got 3,000, 2,000, 3,000 people, and then all of a sudden you can get this magnificent silence after the Gospel, after the homily, or after Holy Communion. And boy, it just, you think, this is exactly what the Church Alive is meant to be. So I walk away from those occasions. My faith is completely invigorated, and it obviously works for a lot of other people too.
One unique characteristic or salient feature on the resume of Father Leonard is that he is a film critic. You have a doctorate in cinematic studies. And he was telling me just a few minutes ago about an amazing Australian film that was, in your opinion, a little bit underrated.
I think it was. It didn't do very well at the box office in the United States. It's called Animal Kingdom.
Yes.
And it is, the woman who was the lead actress in it, an Australian actress called Jackie Weaver, was nominated for Best Supporting Actress at the Oscars this year. She lost out to Helen and Bonham Carter for her portrayal of the Duchess of York in The King's Speech, which was also an excellent performance. But I loved Animal Kingdom. It's not an easy film. So we've got to tell our viewers right now that you've got to know what you're getting out if you're going to get out on DVD, because it's a tough film about a crime family. But the thing it portrays magnificently is the culture of destruction that this is handed from one generation to the next. Just as goodness and good values and courtesy and manners and all of those things are from one to the next, so too can destructive and dreadful traits. And that film shows it writ large. We get the third generation who start to get involved in some really destructive behavior. And you start to see the seeds of how that actually happens in society. So I think it's a wonderful film.
Now, that film shows how destructive forces or the forces of evil can be literally passed on from one generation to another. We can basically go to the antithesis of that and talk about your story and your family of faith and conviction, which you tell in a very intimate way in your new book, which we see on the screen, and that it's here, Where the Hell is God? And let me tell you, it is an amazing book because, as the preface says, it is not an academic treatise on pain and suffering, but it is really an account that comes from the heart, and you really have an amazing basically dissertation of the soul to tell.
It came out of a very painful and tragic experience in my own family when my sister, 22 years ago, was involved in a car accident and was left a quadriplegic. And in response to that, my mother, who's a very devout Catholic, a daily Mass goer, and You know, would say the rosary every day, and probably one of the best Catholics I know. She said really plaintively the day that we found out about Tracy's situation, where the hell is God? And most people read the title of the book as being very angry, but it was just sort of very desolate. It was one of those terrible moments that some Catholics get to where they just feel God has left them and they're bereft. And in the months and weeks that followed that accident, we got some terrible letters from some of the nicest Catholics we knew who wrote and said things like, well, God has had to punish Tracy in this life, or God only sends the biggest crosses to those who can bear them, so you're very blessed, or Tracy's sending up beautiful building blocks to heaven where she'll have a mansion in the sky when she dies. And the more we read these, rather than draw us closer to God, it was really quite alienating. So all of these years later, I decided that if that's the best we can say to people in pain and suffering, we have to have another go. So I didn't want to write an academic book. I wanted to write a short book. I wanted to write an accessible book. I wanted to write a book which went right to the heart of the matter and tried to say something to those people who may be in pain or have ever asked that question or a question like it. And at the moment, it's doing extremely well. People are finding it very, very helpful.
One of the amazing things that really called to me in this book is that God does not directly send pain, suffering, and disease. He does not punish us, does not send us accidents to teach us things, though we can learn from them. That's very powerful.
Well, you know, I say in the book that disease, death, and destruction can't be in God, because 1 John 1:5 says, God is light. In him there is no darkness. And if God is sending cancer or killing our kids or sending tsunamis in a very active and direct way, which is the way some people talk, then the idea is then they have to originate in God, that they must be at God's disposal, within God's nature. But we actually don't say that in classical theology. And so I think our language needs to reflect more accurately what we actually believe. So while I think bad things happen to good people, like my sister, and while, in fact, good things have happened as a result, for instance, my sister has gone on to, through a voice-activated computer, write her own book, which has come out in the United States, too, just recently, called The Full Catastrophe, by Tracy Leonard, and Paulus Press have also published that, then, in fact, that doesn't make the original event good. And sometimes we'll look back and say, well, you know, that happened so that all of these other good things happen. Well, it's good the good things happen, but the original bad thing doesn't become good because good things flowed from it. So really what the book is, one of the things the book is trying to do is attend to our language and giving us a new way of saying very important things about our faith at the time when most people are often open to listen to things of faith when they're trying to find meaning in suffering or in pain.
That's so relevant, right? This second, Japan is literally experiencing a triple disaster. An earthquake, the subsequent tsunami, the current nuclear crisis, and I'm sure that there are many people and there are many who are asking themselves this very question.
I think in the book I have a chapter devoted to natural evil where tsunamis and earthquakes and other things like that. My country's just lived through a 10-year drought and then dreadful floods in the last couple of months.
Yes.
So these have been very significant issues in our own life. But God doesn't send these things. Rather than when people ask, why did the tsunami happen? Well, I think we can go to geophysics more than we can go to theology. We can say the earth shelf moved. And that's a pretty good place to start. So let's talk about the crust of the earth. Now, God ultimately has to take some responsibility for creating the world evolving as it is, unsettled physically as it is. But there's obviously a purpose to that in the sense that the earth itself then gives off energy and gives off power, and it too is evolving, as indeed we are as a human community as well. But the whole idea that God sits in heaven and says, now I'm going to send an earthquake to you and a drought to you and a flood to you. So it also raises the question of what we do when we pray, because lots of people during the 10-year drought in Australia kept saying, well, let's pray for rain. And the problem becomes, well, what if the rain doesn't come? Doesn't God care, or doesn't God know, or aren't we praying hard enough? Aren't we saying the right prayers? So in the book, I have a go at trying to recraft what it is we do when we pray, particularly in intercessory prayer, by saying that our prayer doesn't change an unchanging God, because we believe that God is unchanging. The first letter of James chapter 5 says God does not change. Mm. And then, so what does our prayer do if it doesn't change God? Well, I think our prayer asks an unchanging God to change me, to change the world. And so it's a question, again, of just giving another series of words that I think gives a new impetus, a new spirit to what we might say and how we might think. And that's helpful for people.
And I think that that remarkably increases our faith, because we hold firm in the love, we hold firm and we trust in a loving God that ultimately provides us the opportunity to change ourselves so that we can change the world.
That's exactly right. And if we don't believe that, then, you know, like, God doesn't come in uninvited. We don't say God barges in because we've got the gift of free will. What we do say is that at our invitation, like, God knocks at the at door of our heart and comes in to change us. And if we all lived the Christian life, we would change the world. We would change it dramatically.
And we are changing the world one person at a time through this live webcast. We thank Father Richard Leonard. His book, Where the Hell Is God, is available through Paulus Press. Thank you so much. You're an inspiration.
Thank you.
And your book is really, really amazing. Thank you for watching. We'll be back shortly. Thank you very much.
You're watching the webcast of the 2011 Los Angeles Religious Education Congress, live from the Convention Center in Anaheim, California. Está sintonizando la transmisión del Congreso de Educación Religiosa 2011 en vivo desde Anaheim, California.